Williams, and I'm here from the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia. I'm really delighted to be here today. I want to thank Sergey Khan and the organizers. I also want to just thank the Kiksaadi who adopted me a couple of years ago, and also the Choctaw Tom from Una, who just gave me a name this weekend, and I'm so sorry to have arrived here just last night, so I've missed most of the conference because of an event in Huna, but I'm really happy to be here today, and I look forward to meeting many of you. I'm not going to read anything this thick. What I have is 5 handouts of photographs, and I only have 5 copies, but I certainly could share one of these with anybody over email. So. I want to just hand these out. Maybe, Chuck, I could hand these to you and you could pass them around. Thank you so much. So originally I had sort of designed this session to be more like a workshop because I really would love to try to engage a dialogue around Lynn Sharridge's photographic collection. We're doing lots of work with several clans on his object collection, but I'm not going to talk about that today. So I'm really interested in working with Lasharge's photographs, and I'm hoping to meet some people who might want to engage in a discussion around them to help me learn more about them and to enable us together to document them in a way that is more relevant to this landscape and this community. So really that's what I'm hoping to do, and I hope that you will not hesitate to come up and talk to me afterward and to introduce yourself. I've been talking with a couple of different Tlingit communities about how we might do that, and we're thinking actually of developing a Facebook page where we might upload a couple of photographs maybe once a week or a couple of months, something like that. And then have maybe a password listserv where you could enter into the site and then we could discuss and add information into the documentation of the photographs. So, so what I really want to do today, my paper is not very formal since I was hoping to use it as kind of a workshop. But I have at least 3 things that I wanted to do. First of all, I wanted to introduce you to and remind some of you of the Lewis Sharridge Digital Archive that we created at the University of Pennsylvania Museum to share the documentation and this rich collection over the web. So that's one of my goals. Then secondly, I wanted to look very closely at one object because it connects with the Tlingit Rebellion at Yakutat. It sort of connects more directly with the theme of this meeting. And then third, I wanted to look together with you at some of Lewis Sharridge's photographs. There are about 500 of those, and so I've just really pulled together a very small selection of those. Lower this a little bit because I can't really see my screen. There you go. I think we're good. All right. Is that okay? Can you hear me? Okay. Okay. So first of all, if any of you don't know about the Lewis Sharridge Digital Archive, Lewis Sharridge was a Tlingit individual who worked actually for the Penn Museum in Philadelphia for a period of 20 years. From 1912 to about 1932. Most of that time he spent here in Alaska in his Tlingit home communities, mostly in the north, in Kwekwan and Haines, but then moved to Sitka as well. And he very systematically documented Tlingit communities. He was a historian and a very astute observer, and interesting, following Rebecca's paper, he really is a person who breaks the stereotypes in many ways. And he worked very hard to record what he saw was the disappearing Tlingit culture. So we have worked really hard together with the Alaska State Museum and Library in the archive there. are some of Lord Shotridge's documents as well. But we have together about 2,000 documents. And this is just I've taken some photographs of the website itself. So the address of the website is at the top. You can just find it by putting into Google the Lord Shotridge Digital Archive, and you'll find it very easily. We work with many Tlingit advisors who helped us develop this website. Harold Jacobs of Central Council, Nora Downhower, Lily Hudson, and Terry Rothkar, and several others contributed to the site and helped us think about how to present it. So you'll see over on the left a menu, but really one of the wonderful things about it is the search tool. You can search on objects and see all of Lord Shotridge's objects that are in the collection. You can also search on his photographs, and just by putting in photographs, all 500 images will come forward. And then you can look at his documents. You can look at sound recordings, I think that's all. Okay, so there are several pages that sort of describe the project. We had terrific funding from IMLS, the Institute of Museum and Library Services, and really what the archive does is pull together Lewis Shotridge's records that are in at least three different locations. His sound recordings are actually now in Indiana at the Archive of Traditional Music. And as mentioned, others are in Juneau at the Alaska State Library, some of his catalog cards, and then the bulk of the collection is in Philadelphia. So Lewis Shotridge was born in 1882. He was a very high-ranking Kwantlen from Klukwan. His mother was Hudit Sa of the Killer Whale Finn House, and his father was George Shotridge, housemaster of the very famous whale house of the famous or powerful Gonactidi clan. He was well educated in Haines at the Presbyterian Missionary School, but interestingly, he was trained in anthropological methods at the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia. He also worked with Franz Boas in New York City, and together Boas and Shotridge developed the first Tlingit grammar that was published pretty early, around 1912 or 13. But as mentioned, over those 20 years, he spent most of his time out here between the northern communities of Klukwan and Haines, and then Sitka. So here is a photograph of the website. If you click on documents, for example, he was very systematic, as I said. And for example, 27 cards are just focused on place names. He very systematically sat down with many maps and charts and wrote down specific locations, and then was working very rigorously to not only find the English word, but to find the Tlingit words as well. I would say that he was really ambitious, and this idea of place names, there are lots of blanks in his work. He died at a pretty young age in the middle of his work. He was actually working toward a book or manuscript on the Tlingit people more broadly, but he didn't complete all of that work because he died at a pretty young age. Again, just a reminder to show you what this website looks like. And as you search on documents, there are many varieties and different ways in which you can enter into Lewis Shotridge's work. He published over 11 essays in the Penn Museum Journal. And these are can be hard to find, but there are links to each one of his essays on this website. And again, there are hundreds of letters, stories, and very specific detailed grammar information, as well as genealogical information. I mentioned the sound recordings. He had about 8 sound recordings, both Tsimshian and Tlingit. And they're really very scratchy because they're really old. Right now, in Indiana, they're working to apply some new, really up-to-date sound recording, new technology that is gonna wipe out a lot of the static, but more importantly, speed up the sound so that they're really sounding a little bit more familiar. The old ones are very slow on the phonographic recording. So that's happening now, and I just checked in with them last week to find out how close they were, but they have a massive amount, and he said it's gonna be a couple of more months. But when we get the new recordings, we'll upload them here as well on the site. Right now, you can click on each one and you can hear them. You can also, as mentioned, search on Chartridge's object collection. As you see down here at the bottom, you can do this alphabetically. And when we made this website, we decided to stay very true to Lori Chartridge's own system of organization. So we used his object names and the way in which he actually described the Tlingit objects that he collected. And so as you see at the bottom, you can just click on the letter and you'll find objects in that order. There's another search mode as well. You can put in terms like clan hat or rattle, but sometimes because of the way that Lori Chartridge just cataloged his things, you may not get everything if you do it on your own. So it can just be helpful to do it this way, going through the whole thing alphabetically. Here's a photograph of, for example, he made two beautiful architectural models, and you might not think of putting in a search term of architecture as your entry into his database. So this is just one example. This is a model of his home community of Klukwan. Okay, so what I also wanted to do now is to just look very closely at one object in his collection, just as a way of showing you. Of course, not every object in the collection has as much rich detail as this one, but this is a really interesting one that connects with the theme of this conference. So this is a staff. And you see here how the website works. There's a brief description of sort of Lori Chartridge's headers for each category. And then at the end up there in blue, you see the Alaska State Library number. When you click on that, in many instances, here's a large photograph of the object. All of the objects are photographed in the round, actually, so you can see them on all sides and underneath as well in many cases. So this is an old spear staff that Lori Chartridge collected. Here is a good example of his catalog card. In this instance, he calls this a staff spear with the name Shanista Watsagahi. And his notes record that this object was taken as a spoil in a form of a spear during a fight with Shanista, I'm not sure I'm pronouncing that correctly, a Russian chief and his men. And at the very top of this card, Lori Chartridge noted that Leonov was a doctor of the Russian-American company stationed at Yakutat in Alaska. On the side, written, you have to turn your head to read it, he notes that the spear blade was cut off at the end of the war with the Russians, and that at some time later, the Tikwiti presented the handle, or this object, the handle, now he calls it a handle, to their brothers-in-law. On the back side of his card, I'll just read this, transcribe it for you. Shanista lived at Okjok, Salmon Stream in Yakutat. He was a cruel man indeed. He saw to it that the natives should not develop into a community with some power of resistance. He took away from their mothers early born or newborn male infants, which he shipped off to his headquarters at Kodiak. And then the older children from 5 to 10 years old, he sent to Nujaku. All the men, he notes, were made to chew spruce gum all day long and to be used on the seams of their ships. Some of the Tlingit men chewed so much that their jaws became so tired out that they could not eat the food. He even constricted a stockade around the mouth of the salmon stream and thus closed it to the free use of the natives. At last, a Tikwiti man named Tunu, by name, appeared on the scene, and in time, this warrior stood triumphantly over the dead body of the Russian chief. In his hand, he held a great staff spear, which had been so familiar to all the helpless native slaves. He held it dripping with the blood of the Russian, who had never hesitated in the use of the deadly weapon against them. Tunuk underwent much torture in the hands of the succeeding Russians. In fact, he notes that he was, on one account, suspended with one leg from the ship's masts, and says that the Russians seem to have had a delight in hearing the victims' cries for mercy, but that Tunuk never did that. And Frederica de Laguna, in her work on Under Mount St. Elias, she actually recorded several stories of this incident. So there is much more detail about who this Tlingit warrior was. He actually was really, really smart, and he learned Russian, and there's actually quite a bit of a more detailed story. And I think that some of you here probably know this story much better than I do. Okay, so as mentioned, LaCharge also took about 500 black and white photographs. And here on the website, you can see that you can just click on photographs and all those images will come forward. And then you can click on each one and look at with more detail. He sort of did many kinds of things in his photographic work. And I think that as LaCharge did in all of his work, he was a really remarkable historian. So he was worrying about modernity and the changes that he saw. This idea of the disappearing Native American, which was something that was an attitude that certainly he must have learned, that was supported through his work with Franz Boas and other non-Native scholars at the University of Pennsylvania. And what he did was he documented many things. He documented a lot of what was happening on a daily basis in the Tlingit communities. And much of this work is very early at Klukwan, so early for Shotbridge is 1915, 1916, 1917. But then into about the mid-1920s, he continues to photograph to the south and in many other areas in the region. But what I think is really interesting is the ways in which he embraced photography as a new way of communicating visions of these Tlingit communities. His images are really, I think, can be seen as an indelible marker of American race relations at this time. He saw Tlingit culture that, yes, was disappearing, and he crystallized this in his photographs. He captured the vanishing Indian, and in some ways he communicated the assumed truths about Native America that many Americans held at the time. In some ways, his images reinforce the broader intellectual currents that undergirded racial inequality and of the time and established presumptions about Native people, many of which, as Rebecca noted, are still endured to this day. He documented Tlingit lives, and here you see in quotes, I've added in his captions. He didn't label all of his photographs, unfortunately, and that's why, in many cases, it would be really terrific to have a discussion and to have you help us better document these images. And I just have selected several for you to get a sense of the breadth of his eye. He also worried about the future and the onset of urban life and the growing capitalist influences that were affecting his communities and the really rapid technological developments that were going on at the time in Alaska. This one from the middle section of the Chilkoot Village, which is not there today. looking at the river, and we noted the methodology and the ways that the Tlingit people fished at the time, standing on these wooden boxes and then throwing their spears into the water. He also noted events such as traditional harvesting, here the herring spawn on this particular date. And he noted what was happening in the Tlingit community. So this, in a way, really challenged the stereotype, without a doubt. He also documented places on the landscape where important events took place in Tlingit stories and history. This one specifically near here in Sitka, where a particular event happened, and he actually wrote the story down and published this, Liven Pond. This is the place where Liven Pond was taken into the salmon world. And this was the subject of one of his public lectures that he gave in Philadelphia in 1922. He also systematically documented places on the landscape. He had a boat that he named the Pen, and he traveled systematically around this region from Tlingit community to community. He documented places on the landscape and essentially captured them as they were at this moment, for fear, in part at least, of the onrushing, what he called the onrushing tide of modernity. Here he is on, here's his son, I think, on his boat, the Pen. He fashioned it in the back. You see he could sleep on his boat, so he went for days traveling around and took many, many photographs. Huna, in 1924, before the fire, 1944. Sitka. Sitka from above, I really like that photograph. Ingoon. As mentioned, Lewis Shartridge really was worrying about the future as well, the impact of mining and also of immigrant communities. Noted some of this in his writings. This is an image of the U.S. Army Around the World flyers right here in Sitka in 1924. So what I want to think about as well with you is about how Shartridge's photographs in the 19-teens and 20s also disrupt this idea of the national erasure of Native people from American life and American culture. And I want to highlight the use of his camera to modernize and to equalize his Tlingit subjects and to challenge this, what was very much a racist logic of the time. This was a time of active promotion of forcible assimilation, boarding schools, religious and cultural oppression, divisive land policies, of course, that devastated communities across the continent. And in many ways, his images become an archive of those processes. But what I really want to suggest is also that, in addition, he uses his camera to document Tlingit life. And I want to think about how he used the power of photography to humanize his Tlingit subjects. And I think this process of using a camera of observation and contemplation allowed Tlingit people to present themselves in particular ways and to envision a better life for themselves that was not the assumed one that non-natives might be thinking about. And instead, I think he used the camera to humanize Tlingit people and their communities. So the photographs show both the struggle for racial justice at the time, but also the struggle to become American citizens. They show both the injustices of the period, but also, I think, importantly, the dignity of the Tlingit people in this period. So in essence, I think that we can see that his photos challenge representations of Tlingit men and women as ineligible for national citizenship. Many of his photos show 20th century modernity, and I'm really got my eye on his use of this word modern, which is sprinkled heavily throughout his work. And I think in a very distinctive way, Louis Chartres was looking back and documenting the past, yet also looking forward at the same time. And he clearly used the Penn Museum as a safe haven at this time and saw it that way. But I don't think by any means that he was thinking very negatively about Tlingit people at this time. And I think it's really important to look at his work at the time and to think about this enormous idea of modernity as he did his work. So his work really does document Tlingit people as modern people, as individuals, and as financially self-sufficient individuals. One of the ways we probably see this most easily is through the clothing that they're wearing. And of course, the United States government in their view at this time, Native people were supposed to be distanced and disassociating themselves from their communities, and then not reusing the technologies of modernity for their own communal self-empowerment. Yet, as his photographs convey in so many ways, his Tlingit subjects challenge the logics of assimilation. And here, I think they live in a world that is so clearly both modern and Native, and it's so clearly their own landscape here in Southeast. And there doesn't appear to me to be a sort of a negative tension between being simultaneously Indian and American. It looks to me, I think one of the ways we can see this is this is a very positive view. I've made some printouts as Chuck passed around. And so, of course, this is just a very small subset of his photographs. And as mentioned, I would like to ask for your help in identifying people in these photographs. As you've seen, in some cases, he did record the Tlingit names of people. Yet, I don't know who those individuals are and which families they're associated with. Many of his photographs are not labeled, like this beautiful image. And so I would really welcome your help in making family connections. A couple of Tlingit colleagues have said that it's easy for them to, if they think carefully, to identify. If they look at an image, they might say, oh, that looks to me like a particular family. And then together, they might together think about and identify individuals. So, of course, a long time has passed, but I'm hopeful. So I really welcome your help. And I have a real personal interest in meeting descendant family members who might be interested and might be related to these individuals. So I would say again that I think his subjects remain inherently Tlingit, situated here on the Tlingit landscape through ongoing maintenance, because photographs suggest the ongoing maintenance of Tlingit cultural forms. As such, his pictures become a potential arena, I think, of resistance. And he notably photographed contemporary Tlingit people living in modern America in their tribal communities. His subjects stand in sharp contrast to the objectifying gaze of some celebrated non-Indian photographers of his day. So in closing, Chartres's images challenge and resist the vanishing Indian theory by subverting the naturalist and timeless notions of Tlingit people and Native Alaskans more broadly. These are not people that are backward or frozen in time or frozen in poverty. And on the contrary, I think his Tlingit subjects are neither defeated nor despondent, but firmly grounded in their Tlingit landscape as modern Tlingit Americans, with Tlingit colleagues discussing the creation of, as I mentioned, we are discussing the creation of a closed Facebook page or something like that. And I would really love to invite you to join that group. And hopefully we could continue the conversation. So I'm very happy to answer any questions that you might have. Thank you so much.
Peter Ford Museum. I had told him about all the pictures. in there, we have all the old neighborhoods, and we developed them, they got money to develop them, and we were more than happy to see our relatives when they were young, and I think this was true of all of Alaska, because during the war, they had to care for enemies infiltrating Alaska. I don't know if you know them, do you?
No, I don't, actually.
Well, yeah, because they would have photographers come. I saw a picture of my mother when she was 20. I mean, that was astonishing. And they were all identified, and many of the young people had never seen their grandmothers or their, you know, if the mother died or anything. They didn't have pictures, and those were great. They were really trying to put them out to sell them. With the local people, I don't know what happened to it. Harold Martin's brother was in charge of one in King, so it was all computerized. And all the pictures applied to all the citizens, all the people looking at the cameras that went to the shore. So we all had a picture. So when we all became Sea Alaska members, it was like a concentration camp. We all had a number. It was still a group. All Indians had a number. It's like the Agadosh. So, anyway, it'd be fun for you to investigate all those pictures.
Thank you. Yeah? Pictures on that. And Lewis was elected president in 1930 of the AMB. And we don't have any photographs from that later period. But I'm actually searching for pictures and documentation about him in that time here in Alaska. So I've got my eye out for them. Yes?
So I was just reading on JunoEmpire.com that sounds like you were in Muna?
Yes.
For the repatriation, partial repatriation.
Right.
So do you have a minute to talk about that?
Sure. Let's see. About 3 or 4 years ago, the Penn Museum repatriated 8 objects that to the Tuktentan Mount Fairweather house, the snail house in Puna. And at that time, the trustees of the university also agreed to work very hard to resituate an additional about 40 objects that are very important historical objects to the Tuktentan at Puna. And it took us a couple of years, but we just signed an agreement with the Huna Indian Association on behalf of the Snail House to work together to resituate those 40 or so objects. So what has happened, I came with 2 other colleagues here this past week, and we hand carried 3 items that we actually took up to the Kuik in Huna, 3 of the 40 objects. And the rest of them under this agreement are very soon, in the next, probably in the next 6 months or so, going to be transferred to the Alaska State Museum, where they will be held until the Huna Indian Association builds its new museum. And they are actively raising money to do so. And we had a tour of the future site of that building. And the collection will be in perpetuity for the tribe and the clan there in Huna. So it's not that we're just transferring them to another museum necessarily. They're just being held at the Alaska State Museum, where they will be for the purpose of making them available to the clan. So at any time when the clan needs them, they will come and sign out the objects and use them in for ceremonial purposes or educational purposes of their choice, until they build their own building, and then they'll move up to Huna.